Hey, buenos dinos. Buenos dias. Good morning again, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, these lights are bright. I think my colleagues in the back are wanting you to see every wrinkle in my face this morning. So, welcome back to day two of the Automotive Logistics Mexico Conference. I hope you all, those of you who joined us, had a good gala dinner last night. Perhaps some of those who really enjoyed it aren't with us this morning, so we'll be seeing them later in the afternoon. Yesterday was really, I think, a special day for us. I hope that you learned a lot and made as many new friends and contacts as we did. I'll go through some of those highlights before I kick off our panel. But again, just a few little housekeeping notes. We do have Wi-Fi in the room that's available. It's sponsored by ProTrans. There you have the Wi-Fi network. I think it's a little different than it was yesterday, but and then the code is ProTrans. And just a reminder again, for those of you who weren't with us yesterday, we do have this session, like all the sessions, is actually being streamed on the internet live and will be archived. There's a, you can actually tweet on the social stream, put questions to me, to the panel, which I can address for them if you're too shy to raise your hand, or just make general comments and communicate with other delegates via the social media. So, to log into the live, you have a link which is actually on your program as well, but it's up there. You need your email address and your delegate number, which is on your badge. So it might seem complicated, but it's quite a nice little facility. Okay, so again, yesterday I thought we had a really great day. Some of the highlights for me included Ildefonso Guajardo, the Secretary of the Economy. He spoke about the importance of Mexico's free trade and open business environment, and particularly the opening up of new potential markets with the Pacific trade deal that Mexico is involved with 12 countries, and also a new and updated agreement with the EU that expects to be negotiated, I think, over the next year or sooner. He also mentioned improving and modernizing NAFTA, and particularly with room for logistics efficiencies, things like custom reform and border operations. So that was kind of some of the headlines from him for me. We also heard from the U.S. Ambassador to Mexico, Anthony Wayne, and he really stressed how important it is for you to communicate as your needs to him. You know, and his job is actually in some ways to facilitate business between the U.S. and Mexico in particular. And obviously there are particular forums and facilities that he's working with to do that. At our lunch table, for example, some of the executives we sat with pointed out some issues on the rail that he hadn't heard of, and he was quite keen to bring back and address with his counterparts in Mexico. So the doors are open, and I think that was a message that he made quite clear. We also heard about the significance and complexity for logistics in Mexico for companies like Delphi, Ford, General Motors, and many others. We heard from Governor Miguel Marquez from the state of Guanajuato that there's considerable investment in state, federal level, in rail, road, airports, inland logistics facilities, helping to improve logistics for the automotive industry. And that, of course, is not to say that we have not also heard about our share of Mexico's challenges. As you know, logistics costs are relatively high, not least because of added security issues. The number of paved four-lane autopistas is still relatively low, and there are high toll costs, which, as I learned from speaking to some yesterday, sounded to be quite a deal higher than in the U.S., for example. So, you know, there's a lot of private investment, which is great, but there's also some higher costs there, too. And the Secretary of the Economy also pointed out yesterday that the lower fuel costs, it might be good news for logistics companies right now, but obviously it also means lower revenues for the government from the petrol economy, and that is going to mean lower revenue. And he stressed that shouldn't affect capital spending, or they'll try not to, but made it pretty clear that there would need to be reductions in the budget, And certainly that'll cause some constraints at a time when Mexico needs as much investment in its infrastructure as possible. So obviously, I think we'll see more private investment and more public-private partnerships going forward. And now to our session at hand, and indeed the last day of the conference. We're going to be looking specifically at the tier supply chain in this session, including in managing component logistics, localization, sourcing and freight patterns within Mexico and North America. And we have a panel of tier ones and logistics providers here that'll really, you know, able to cover this from many angles. Let me just briefly introduce them to you. We'll first hear from Robert Ryan, who's the supply chain director for Mexico and Central America at Cummins. We have Frank Bateman, who's the director of custom solutions at Ryder Supply Chain Solutions. John Godfrey, the director of logistics and purchasing at Pirelli Tire North America. Volker Vossler, the vice president of operations of Mexico for Seglo Logistics Schnellecke. And last but certainly not least, Michael Silvio, senior director of supply chain management at Cooper Standard. Again, maybe just a bit of context from my side. Obviously, you know, the supply base has been growing in Mexico for 50 years, as the Secretary of the Economy pointed out yesterday. And there is a very well-developed, I would say, supply base here across many major commodities, powertrains, and technologies. I thought it was an interesting point, again, that was made yesterday, that with the reform and opening up of the energy sector and the lower energy prices, it could pave the way for new commodities like a plastic industry as such, which could again have more implication for the auto supply base as a whole. It'll also be interesting to see if the degree that the high-tech industry invests further in Mexico and see some of that those components, which maybe traditionally came out of Asia, also being built here. And indeed, with investment from premium car makers, Audi, BMW, Mercedes-Benz, Infiniti, I think we'll see more investment across the value chain in Mexico. And with that, of course, will come new logistics schemes and concepts. For example, at Audi's new plant in San Jose, Chiapa, I know there's a supplier park next to the plant. Some 20 suppliers will be based there doing assembly, pre-assembly, line feeding. So again, there'll be some interesting changes and shifts, I think, coming up in the supply base. But now I'm going to turn it over to our experts. And again, it'll be the similar format. We'll have some presentations and comments from the panel, and then we'll open it up to Q&A at the end. So first up, Robert.
Buenos dias a todos. Mi nombre es Bob Ryan.
I am Bob Ryan, and I will talk about transformation of supply chain in Cummins. In Cummins, we have four business units: engines, power generation, components, and distribution. Our business units of components, we have fuel systems, filtration, emission solutions, and turbo technologies. Our vision in the supply chain is to establish supply chains that are reliable, triggered by the market, that will yield profitable growth. As I said, triggered by the market, including an approach on customer needs, alignment of timing from start to delivery, and emphasis in globalization to establish our capacities above the demand and to address with efficiency difficulties to reduce risks. We are reliable through a coordinated integration between business units and functions, and also through the provision of an appropriate capability, scalability, fastness, and time of response. Supply chains in Cummins operate over key principles to consistently comply with our customer needs, optimize all our facilities and functions for the benefit of a single Cummins, perfect deliveries between facilities and functions, anticipate and answer to market fluctuations in a timely fashion. Our Cummins supply chains include development by delivery and customer support. We have three subjects in our supply chain. One, to improve our customer service, improve speed and flexibility, improve logistics network and capabilities, manage the complexity of products through a proposed differentiation, and developed functional excellence. The situation for the future would be starch. From multiple facilities to a single specific storage facility. And from a comprehensive logistic network of storage facility for companies, distribution centers, and cross docks. We also have five models as a supply chain. We include a flexible model with an engineering solution and another flexible model with configured solution, efficient model which is agile and responsive. Our filtration facility, they have flexible models, efficient, agile, and responsive. Our growth is generating the needs of our supply chains with a greater capacity for response. Globalization and expansion are pressuring our capability to respond, and vertical integration has been reduced, and with this complexity of resource acquisitions has increased. Our customers demand each time more and are expecting shorter delivery times. Our product's complexity is exerting pressure in our capabilities. Within the company, dependency is increasing both in complexity and seriousness. To make an advantage of deliveries during the process, this is one goal. We have a simple example. Our components facilities, delivery in time to EBU, which is engine business units, and from this unit, delivery on time to power generation. Engine use for the power generation business unit to build an electric station. And distribution business unit services, we have been profitable for the past 20 years. But actually, how is it? We have many suppliers and many components plants. And they deliver to engine business units, to power generation business units, to distributors business units. And we also have customers and OEMs. So this adds to the complexity. To be fast is a fundamental element for the transformation and will yield operational and financial benefits, greater capability, an increase in efficient and quick production, shorter throughput time, shorter delivery times, lead times, shorter time to launch to market, expedite decision making, best customer service levels, and lower costs. We also have many opportunities for our suppliers in Mexico. Localization of material in Mexico is important, and we also have potential to link to global opportunities. More diverse suppliers and greater business opportunities, including factoring, consolidation of transport, and optimization of the fleet network, freight network. Quality, it's important, zero defects, and total cost reduction, including Six Sigma projects. Sustainability, to improve the environment and those communities where we live and work. And for our suppliers, they will become part of the One Cummins network. Our localization, our supply localization plan of Mexico from 2015 to 2018, our approach will be localization of supply for our Mexico's facilities with the goal of 50% of supply localization for the year 2018. Acquisition plan aligned to the global organization in order to leverage resources and volumes through our business units. Sustainability, it's also important for us in the supply chain for Cummins. We have three objectives. One is energy, waste, and last, water. In Mexico, water is important. And in San Luis Potosí, we also have some water issues and underground water, 1 or 2 meters per year. So sustainability, and we must approach on energy, waste, and water. It's really important in our supply chain. And the environmental challenge in our communities, we have eco clubs with schools in San Luis Potosí and the city of Juarez. We have projects in Parque Morales at San Luis Potosí. Living Roof, this is a project with Sierra de Álvarez. A reforestation project, and a vegetable garden. These are some projects that we have with the communities. We want to pass these on. Now, do you have any question? Tú deseas hacer las preguntas al final. Muchas gracias. Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Y muchas gracias.
So bad as well in not speaking Spanish. But thank you for a great presentation there, highlighting some of the key issues there for Cummins, from logistics and localization. And yeah, I think we'll definitely have some questions at the end. Next up, Frank Bateman from Ryder.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank Automotive Logistics for allowing me the opportunity to participate in today's panel. It's very exciting to see all the recent interest in Mexico and investment from the OEMs in Tier 1s. But one thing I'd like to point out is that the country's automotive sector did not just happen overnight. In fact, the big three auto manufacturers, General Motors, Ford, and Chrysler, have operated in Mexico since the 1930s. A few decades later, Volkswagen and Nissan built Mexican plants. Today, dozens of manufacturers have assembly plants in Mexico, with more on the way. What they are calling the auto boom in Mexico has really taken hold in the last 3 years. Since 2012, Nissan has invested $2.2 billion in Aguascalientes, while Volkswagen has invested $1.4 billion in various sites in Mexico. In Guanajuato alone, Honda has invested $800 million and Mazda has invested $650 million. I think we can all agree Mexico is truly experiencing an automotive boom, and the challenges, as well as opportunities, have never been bigger. Before we dive into the topic, I'd like to give you a little background about our company. Ryder's history began in 1933 when Jim Ryder purchased his first Model A truck in Miami, Florida. Over the years, Ryder grew throughout the U.S. as a leading provider of commercial transportation, logistics, and supply chain management solutions. In 1994, Ryder increased its service offering to include Ryder de Mexico. Today, we employ over 28,000 people in the U.S. and nearly 2,500 in Mexico. Our carrier base includes over 1,700 carriers in the U.S. and over 150 carriers under contract in Mexico. Why are we as a company qualified to discuss Mexico and cross-border logistics? The answer is simple. Ryder isn't just talk when it comes to Mexico. Ryder has taken the time to understand Mexico and cross-border logistics and invested in operations at key border locations and major cities throughout the country. Some examples on the border include Nuevo Laredo, Juarez, and Tijuana. We have established multi-client service facilities in Mexico City, Guadalajara, and Monterrey, the major metropolitan markets that form Mexico's Golden Triangle. This triangle represents nearly 80% of the country's industry base and commerce. We thought it important to recognize our automotive customers, both OEMs as well as Tier 1s. Over the years, we have learned very much and grown side by side with our professional partners. If it were not for them, we would not be who we are today in Mexico. We don't take it for granted and appreciate the privilege to work with these world-class organizations, many of whom are participating in today's conference. As a Mexican 3PL or third-party logistics provider, Ryder delivers customized inbound logistics solutions for OEMs and Tier 1s, as well as aftermarket logistics and finished vehicle logistics. Each category brings its own unique set of challenges, and for that very reason, we employ the use of subject matter experts, or SMEs. For example, in the case of OEM inbound logistics, our subject matter experts have spent years working with auto manufacturers developing strategies to deal with the unique challenges of starting up a greenfield plant. They examine the ramp-up stages and determine the best mode of transport to get the parts to the plant as quickly and cheaply as possible, given the material cube and weight. We also employ teams that have spent years working in the world of Tier 1s. They have come to understand the complexities of what is commonly referred to as Tier 2 purchase parts versus internal sourced parts. Although these two worlds are different, they have many commonalities regarding sensitivity to both transit time as well as cost. The golden rule is to never, ever shut the plant down under any circumstances. There is a different focus for finished vehicle and aftermarket logistics. With finished vehicles, it's paramount to keep accurate, up-to-the-minute yard inventories. Intermodal knowledge and experience with rail switching is not only useful, but a must. In the case of aftermarket logistics, our SMEs are charged with optimizing routes to service the parts distribution centers, or PDCs, and the customer dealers. The challenge becomes how to run an efficient network with an ever-changing volume and mix of spare parts. In the world of aftermarket, the dealers are king, and logistics providers must do everything in their power to deliver the parts as quickly as possible. So how exactly do we support the OEMs, Tier 1s, and auto dealers? One answer could be to say that Ryder provides transportation management, distribution management, value-added services, and network management. But a more comprehensive way to describe it would be to say that Ryder acts as a change agent for supply chains. We integrate all aspects of the network as a 4PL or LLP and optimize a customer's entire automotive network. Through a culture of lean, Ryder provides thought leadership, proactive solutions, and integrated technology that all deliver tangible benefits to our customers. Some of these benefits include 99% inventory accuracy, 98% on-time performance, improved cash flow, and profitability. Network design provides a holistic view of the supply chain. By simulating various supply chain configuration alternatives, logistics engineers can compare cost and service trade-offs across a set of potential scenarios. The first step is to create the value stream map. This is an example of a level one, or high-level value stream map. It shows the entire supply chain from beginning to end. You can see the material being picked up at the suppliers, then hauled via different modes of transport to distribution centers, and finally shipped to the consuming plant. A high-level value stream map like this one can be used to set strategic objectives, highlight key milestones, identify non-value-added steps, and define total transit time from point of pickup to point of delivery. In order to develop a robust value stream map, we identify and empower a cross-functional team that dedicates the necessary time to work together. What you get out of the tool is what you put into it. Although a high-level value stream map might be intimidating, you can scale it back as much as you need in order to be useful. More focused material flow visualization, such as this, could be a good starting point. The key is to include all the steps from origin to final destination. In the case of material moving from a Mexico Tier 1 supplier to US OEM, milestones could include raw material pick at the origin, transit to the Mexico side of the border, border dray, processing at Mexico and US customs, US transit, and final delivery to an OEM plant in the US. Flows like this can be developed for inbound raw material to an automotive manufacturing facility or inbound aftermarket parts to a spare parts distribution center. The key is that it is a living document that must be continuously updated and improved. When I talk about value stream mapping, I cannot stress enough the importance of the lean guiding principles, which include people involvement, built-in quality, standardization, short lead time, and continuous improvement. These result in empowered team members, less waste, increased productivity, and cost savings. The idea of lean is to challenge every aspect of the business in order to get better. It employs the use of Kaizen to remove waste and encourages employee suggestions. In other words, it is the thousands of little ideas that make the biggest impact. A good 3PL centralizes communication and provides end-to-end visibility via the control tower concept. In essence, they act like the air traffic control tower in an airport, coordinating between all of your supply chain partners, whether they're material suppliers, carriers, or customs brokers. The 3PL operates on a set of predetermined business roles that govern how to handle key milestones identified through the value stream mapping process. The control tower manages events on an exception basis and communicates back out instructions to your suppliers and carriers. For all intents and purposes, your 3PL acts as your eyes and ears with their finger on the pulse of your supply chain, whether it's in the US, at the border, or in Mexico. Although many providers claim to provide door-to-door visibility, many truly only have proficiency in only one or two out of three. A strong 3PL should cover the entire NAFTA corridor. As a Mexico and cross-border 3PL, a significant part of our job is to continuously work to establish the most comprehensive security plans possible. On a typical day in 2013, Customs and Border Patrol processed over 992,000 passengers and pedestrians, 67,000 truck, rail, and sea containers, and 269,000 incoming privately owned vehicles. While processing this traffic, they seized nearly 12,000 pounds of drugs and $291,000 in undeclared or illicit currency. All of this on a daily basis. With increased U.S.-Mexico cross-border business and traffic comes the underside, increased smuggling and risks to your cargo. We encourage our customers to complete a comprehensive risk assessment and use high-security seals for all cross-border shipments. We also recommend that distribution centers and drop lots have visitors' logs, key card access, and on-site guards. CCTV functionality is recommended since cameras are a major deterrent to criminal activity. Regarding transportation, we encourage that all the carriers we use in Mexico and the border have GPS monitoring. As a Mexico and cross-border 3PL, we participate in custom-sponsored programs such as CTPAT or Customs Trade Partnership Against Terrorism. Some benefits of the program include reduced number of CBP examinations, front-of-the-line inspections, possible exemption from stratified exams, shorter wait times at the border, and access to the free and secure trade or FAST lanes at land borders. FAST is a commercial clearance program for known low-risk shipments entering the U.S. from Canada and Mexico. It allows expedited processing for commercial carriers who have completed background checks and fulfilled certain eligibility requirements. By participating in U.S. and Mexico Customs voluntary programs, you'll open your company to a wealth of knowledge and best practices. To learn more about Ryder and other logistics topics, you can visit our website, read our informational blogs, which I highly recommend, or contact myself via email. Thank you very much.
Thanks again, Frank, giving us an overview from the third-party logistics point of view. And again, we'll come back to more of those topics in the Q&A. We'll now hear from the tire side of the business. It's John Pirelli from Pirelli. John Godfrey from Pirelli.
Good morning. So, Pirelli, we're the fifth largest tire manufacturer in the world. We have 23 factories in 14 different countries. We're the inventor of ultra-high performance tires and speed-rated tires. We're original equipment on some of the world's finest premium vehicles around the world. And we're recognized as the most sustainable company in the auto parts sector by Dow Jones and FTSE. So we have a commercial presence on six continents in 160 countries. Our industrial focus is on premium tire manufacturing in developing countries. In the NAFTA region, we have two factories. We have one factory in Rome, Georgia, and we have a new factory in Silao in Mexico. Our newest factory in our global network is in Indonesia. This will be manufacturing motorcycle tires. This year, 64% of our production will be coming from factories that are 10 years old using our latest technology. So, Pirelli's presence in NAFTA and in Mexico. Our focus is producing and selling tires for passenger vehicles, both cars and light trucks. We also sell motorcycle tires in the region. We're forecasted to sell around 8 million tires in the NAFTA region this year. Our North American original equipment customers include Mercedes, BMW, Ford, General Motors, Volkswagen, Chrysler, and Fiat. Like I said, we have a manufacturing plant in Silao. This plant will be producing 60% of the tires sold in the NAFTA region eventually. Its focus is on producing premium tires, which includes high-performance and ultra-high-performance tires for cars and light trucks. This year, we'll be producing around 3 million tires. And when fully operational in 2017, we're expected to produce 5.5 million tires. So, why did we open a factory in Mexico? We wanted to take advantage of nearshoring or local for local benefits. What are these? First of all, we were forecasted to sell around 8 million tires in the region. And with importing basically 95% of our production from overseas sources, many of which were long pipelines, including China, Brazil, Romania, it was really not possible to continue to grow in our market. It required a huge working capital investment of keeping a 90-day stock pipeline from these countries. So being in Mexico, we're able to shorten our supply pipeline and carry less safety stock. Of course, we have logistics savings being in Mexico on international transportation, and we're able to provide direct deliveries to our customers in both the original equipment and replacement channels. The factory is dedicated to our market and gives us increased flexibility to serve our market in terms of volume, product mix, and timing. This allows us to go from a make-to-stock to really a make-to-order logic. We can get an order from a customer and make tires to that order and have them in the U.S. or in Canada in just several weeks. This has also given us increased availability for a product mix dedicated to the NAFTA tire requirements. These would be sizes specific for light truck, an SUV, and then the all-season preference here in North America. Of Of course, we also have custom savings with NAFTA, and also specific to the U.S. tire market, we avoid the U.S. import tire tariffs that come on Chinese tires. So, Pirelli's facility in Silao, we're forecasted to be investing by 2017 $400 million U.S. dollars, and we will have created 1,800 jobs here in Mexico. 70% of the production in Silao is for the U.S. and Canadian market, and the other 30% is for the local Mexican market. So, like I said, our location is in Silao in the state of Guanajuato. We're in an industrial park that Volkswagen is also in. It's in the Puerto Interior. So our location in respect to our two primary US DCs, one in California, one in McDonough, this allows us to serve those very well. We use about 80% intermodal transportation, the other 20% is truck. So we announced the construction of this factory in 2010 and started construction that same year. And then in 2011, the factory was finished and we started our first tire manufacturing. So the groundbreaking on our factory was in November of 2010. In November of 2011, in less than 1 year, we had produced our first tire. This was an extremely aggressive timeline, and really, it was quite amazing that we were able to do this in less than 1 year. So our factory is one of the most advanced modern factories in the tire industry. We have the most advanced tire building technology for our premium products. So just to show you our factory here, the raw materials come in at the top. We make the compounds, the rubber compounds for the tires. We then create the semi-finished goods. Then we build the green uncured tire. Then we cure that tire. And then we have our final finishing department where the tires are inspected and ready for the market. Then they're delivered to our warehouse there at the bottom. Our factory is extremely modern and green. We minimize use chemicals. We treat 100% of our water. It is also a very energy efficient factory. So like I said, this factory is dedicated to the NAFTA market, making tires specific for the NAFTA market. So throughout US, Canada, and Mexico, we're also producing tires for original equipment manufacturers in North America, that then those cars can be exported worldwide, so then we also make aftermarket tires that go on those original equipment fitments. So premium is very important to Pirelli. Our tires, we make premium tires. This means premium raw materials, premium processes, and of course, premium people involved. Security is of utmost concern to us being in Mexico, both in the domestic distribution within Mexico and also for our exports to the US and Canada. We are Tier 3 CTPAT in both the US and in Mexico. The factory has all the certifications expected in our industry around quality, health and safety, environment, loss prevention, and security. We also have the legal authorization to make tires for the Brazilian market, Chinese market, European, and of course, US market. We have homologations and fitments, either present or future, with Ford, Volkswagen, Chrysler, Mercedes, Audi, and BMW. So, what is our warehousing and distribution network in NAFTA? Like I said, we have two main DCs in the US, one in California, one in McDonough, Georgia. They have about a 65-70% split in Georgia and the remaining 30% in California. We also have two warehouses in Mexico. One is our factory and distribution warehouse in Silao, and we also have a small premium warehouse in Mexico City just to serve the aftermarket premium market in Mexico City. We have two warehouses in Canada, one in the Greater Toronto Area, one in Vancouver. And then our original equipment business, we serve the US original equipment customers from our McDonough, Georgia, DC, and then we serve our Canadian original equipment customers from our Brampton, Ontario warehouse. So in conclusion, I'd like to tell you just how Pirelli has transformed its supply chain over the last several years. First of all, more NAFTA production, Higher NAFTA sales means that we're increasing our market share here in the NAFTA region. We've decreased our reliance on long pipeline sources like Brazil, China, and Romania. This is allowing us to decrease our overall inventory while maintaining high service levels. Mexico production gives us lower international transportation costs and allows us to do direct orders to U.S. customers, both in the original equipment and aftermarket channels. Over the last 2 years, our fill rates in the replacement channel have improved dramatically. We've gone from 60% to almost 90% fill rates. We've reduced our overseas imports from 95% to 70% with the startup of our Mexican plant. And within several years, we're going to be at greater than 50% production for the NAFTA region here in the U.S. and in Mexico. So we've also gone through a network re-engineering project several years ago. This allowed Pirelli to reduce the number of warehouses that we were operating in the U.S. and Canada, distribution costs while maintaining the same service level. Currently, we're going through another round of network re-engineering and 3PL tendering. This will be activated in 2016. This will further improve our cost structure and increase our service levels to our customers throughout the NAFTA region. So I thank you for your time, and I look forward to your questions later on.
Thank you very much, John. We've heard about trends, near sourcing and regionalization, and there it is in the flesh, in fact, or in the rubber, perhaps I should say, with the factory in Mexico and a much more reduced reliance on imports. An opportunity coming next year with another round of network engineering. So all interesting stuff. I look forward to the questions there, but I'd like to now invite Volker Vossler from Seglo Logistics Schnellecke.
No funciona nada más aquí.
Once again, good morning. Quiero agradecer a Chris, a Luis por la invitación. Parecería que ayer todo el mundo la pasó bien después de la cena. En la cena encontramos menos energía de lo esperado en el grupo. Pero pues nunca hay que subestimar el potencial de la pachanga en México. Tengo 19 años en México y a donde va uno en cualquier momento siempre existe la posibilidad de hacer fiesta. Cuidado los visitantes. Quiero enfocarme ahora en los factores de éxito para la logística y particularmente ahí pueden apreciar para la gente lo que tiene que ver con el éxito gracias a la gente y cuáles son los desafíos que presenta México. Quiero hablar un poco de lo que es nuestra compañía Seglo Logistics Schnellecke. Seglo es de Schnellecke. Seglo Logistics es la compañía más grande en logística desde 1939 a nivel mundial. Y bueno, ya me di cuenta que estoy hablando inglés y quería hablar en español, perdón, cambio. So as I was saying, here we have a world presence of Schnellecke, almost 20,000 employees all over the world. And since 1997, we have also operations in Mexico. We have operations in Mexico throughout the country with 15 business units, more than 7,000 employees in Mexico, and with a significant number of clients in Mexico. Well, to start my presentation, what are the success factors for logistics? There is something we see here which is very simple. What are the needs our clients have? The main client needs, everyone wants the right material in the right place with the right quality and the right amount or the right cost. This is very simple, but I can assure you, if we comply with this, there is pure happiness everywhere. But it is not as simple as it may seem. And usually our clients, what do? They reflect their requirements in KPIs and scope of work to have the right levels for these requirements. What is our work, our task? First of all, we need to produce the service the client wants with implementation, operation of tailor-made solutions and standardized processes for the service to our clients. Also, as logistics provider, we also have needs. What are our needs? We also need the right thing. In this case, above all, the foundation for the right service is to have the right people, the right processes, and to have the right systems. These systems will be supporting internal people and processes, you may wonder. And, well, where are the facilities? The equipment, the facilities can be purchased anytime. Rather than that, these elements are important to drive success rather than the facility or the equipment that you can get it anywhere. If you wonder why I didn't include that, the right people, the right knowledge, the right place, the right attitude are necessary. The right knowledge is necessary in order to focus on low cost and right time. That's part of our supply chain, the right people and the right process in order to supply our services. Let me share about our business model. On the one hand, we have people 100%. This is the other side. We have the processes, know-how, supported with information management, and out of this, we are having our services. Here on the side, we have 100% of the people. With these processes, we can have the right manpower, staffing. We see people, and everything is client-oriented. On the other side, we have a consulting type of service. 100% of the know-how of the process handled by a few people. If we have the right marriage, if we have the right combination of these two parts, we are able to have our core business, what we are currently doing, for handling the design of technology, people management, to provide processes and the responsibility for the whole process. This is the way we view things and how we are interpreting our business. And here we have the services that we have in these three areas, in these three columns. It is nothing strange. These are the right requirement selection payroll, but we have also legacy things. We provide training for people, for our clients, focused on the process. The people want to, the manager want to execute with the people. That has to do with logistics. We are also handling here two brands, as shown on the slide for Mexico, with Seglo Logistics. Some issues for Mexico. This is the same information what Hector shared yesterday in with Delphi. This is similar. Here you see the number of students that go to elementary school, how many go to intermediate, middle school, high school. In conclusion, we see how the number of people trained at the university level are very few. Just 10 students do their university and only 2 students try graduate courses. What we see here is the issue, the problem. The problem takes place at all levels, not only in terms of education, but this is seen at all levels of the education system. Here we see the topic of education. We lack skilled people. We lack the technicians that we need to execute the service. Chris was talking about some of these issues as well yesterday. Same source. from the World Economic Forum, the quality of education, and it's been said that Mexico ranks 123 in terms of education quality, 143 out of 144 countries. So these are the important points. What we have to face in Mexico, we have a lack of skilled labor. Well, we know there are people, but what we have found, we lack skilled labor. We cannot hire people for our operations who are not sufficiently trained to be productive. That's not the case. It is not possible. So we started to face this reality, and there is another situation in Mexico. In comparison with other regions and countries, personnel turnover rate is higher. Sometimes you hear the numbers and you say, is that an annual number? No, on a monthly basis, high turnover rate. This has to be handled. This, we have to cope with this. Yes, the geographic location is here, but we are here, we want to be here, and we have to take care of that. With our years present in Mexico, we have already developed our procedures, or the right way how we are coping with this situation. We are trying to find and to keep the right person, the right personnel. Here we have a series of processes in place. This is something everybody is has heard about it. Organizational chart, the looking for the right personnel. We have different standards for recruitment and selection. For example, what we are doing, we do a turnover rate of non-turnover rates in order to have a stable profile of our people. Not only a stable profile, but this is related to the people. We have people devoted particularly to look for the people that we need in the right area, so that we train them and so that we bring them to the right level to do our service. This is not very common among many other activities that we do in Seglo. This is also the so-called onboarding process. Turnover rate is very high in the first months. The people that we have there from in our operations, they come from an area, maybe from architecture, and they're not used to industry. They get scared. You may remember your first day of work, you were welcomed with open arms, and yes, everybody was happy. But if there is a line running, there is a lot of stress in the people if they are not well trained. We accompany them, we take them by the hand and show them the process so that we can take care of any situation in the first months of a new employee. Training, another key part of Seglotech, as we call it. This is available in all our operations throughout the Mexican Republic. From the very beginning in the classroom, we are taking the people in the classroom from quality project KPIs industry, and we expose them to these topics so that they get used to this. And during the training, the training they get with us during the practice, we also have simulators. Here we example of automotive equipment. These are simulators where people, before they go to the actual operation, they have to be trained with the simulators. We also have this for the simulator, physical simulator process in all the corporations. And this is a listing of the main services that we need to offer our clients. So we have the simulators. We are training our people. Each one of the workers has to have a million number of repetitions so that they are ready, like as if they were a robot. At the end, people are used to the process in a very short period of time. In a few days, they are ready and productive as we need them. Also, we have started with other efforts for some reasons. The virtual training, virtual environment training. We get advantages. Everybody knows Xboxes. So in our training centers, people are virtually trained with the processes. Here we have the screen, we move this like what you have at home, and they are learning. This way they're learning the individual processes. This by no means replaces practical simulators, but basically for the new millennials who were growing up with these technologies, first they need to learn the process, but then when they go to the real world, it is very fast. This gives us flexibility through our training focus. We need the machinery, we just get the room, and then we get started right away. This training allows us to increase our capacity and to have flexibility to train on the site as well. There are many more examples of other activities that we are doing on technical competencies for specialties that we do in Seglo Logistics. Everything is focused on the services that we are providing, and also on to have excellence in leadership for middle managers and supervisors. This is very important. On the one hand, we are training our leaders so that they can face the variety of people they need to work with, so that the people working in the company will not represent a problem or to do something else, because we know personnel management is one of the critical items in Mexico. Elsewhere the focus may be different, but the working environment, working with people, is very important, and that we take into account. Here we have some other slides of what I have already said, and this is so far what I wanted to share with you about Seglo Logistics. Thank you.
That hit on a lot of really key points. We spoke yesterday as well about human capital and the importance of training and education in the supply chain. And it's great to see a company putting so much focus on that. I'll be interested to have a few questions on that, particularly hear some differences maybe with other parts of the world. But before we do the Q&A, I'd like now to invite Mike Silvio from Cooper Standard.
Good morning, everybody. I'm from Cooper Standard. We're a $3.5 billion company with 7 locations in Mexico with our last acquisition, and we've 80 locations around the world, so there's lots of activity in logistics. And I'm also associated with Wayne State University, where I teach in their program, and I'm also teaching the AIG program. And so when it comes to discussions like this, I have a file of lectures that I give to my students, and I go back and I pull that lecture out. And I pulled out my notes on risk and supplier development and such, and I thought about it, and I thought, you know, this really isn't anything new or anything fresh or any kind of commentary that I thought would catch Christopher's ears, because he's always looking for that next quote. And so yesterday when I was on the treadmill, I thought something jumped in my head, so I took everything that I'd written, I threw it away, and I kind of put together a fresh set of notes based on one thought. Risk isn't the same as it used to be. Risk is different. Okay? 10 or 12 years ago, 15 years ago, companies like Cooper Standard and probably a lot of the companies that you work for made this rush to Asia for low-cost goods, and the cost savings were incredible. 35, 45, 55% savings. It was amazing. And so risk really wasn't that important to us, because that savings could overcome any risk. So what do? We added inventory, buffer stock. You know, they added planes that go from Asia to Chicago and Atlanta to move goods. And so the bulk of the risk was, I guess, you know, it was pushed aside because of these great savings that we had on the piece price side. So things have changed a little bit now in Asia, right? The costs have increased. Why have they increased? Well, you know, the wages have increased a little bit. Certainly, they've had to invest a ton of money in their infrastructure. And probably most importantly, they've really improved their pricing models, and they've raised their prices to be really just shy of our prices on so many commodities for what we can buy in North America. And the result of that is higher costs for us, and certainly more millionaires and billionaires in China than ever before, because they figured out that they can make more money. So when those margins come down for companies that source there, all of a sudden risk takes a front seat again, because we're not saving 55%, we're not saving 45%, we're not saving 35 or 25%. Now those savings are maybe 10%, 5%. And sometimes they're really competing on an even and level field with us when it comes to pricing. So now that risk management is really important, and we're talking about it. Again, risk isn't what it used to be. It has to be managed differently. Now, we also manage our business differently. In the post-recession time, when I think back to 2009 versus now, we're really managing our business differently. We're managing it by the income sheet, by the income statement, the balance sheet. We're looking at how our ratios are you know, how we're performing much differently. We always did that, but now it's harder to get funding. It's harder to get investors. And so we really have to manage that income statement. And so an emergency, a risk that we weren't ready for, that costs us money, has a major effect on how our company performs. I can fix a problem locally for $350. I can fix a problem in North America when expedite $3,000, $5,000. But when it comes to an emergency that happens overseas, it's $35,000, maybe $350,000, maybe $1,350,000 to fix that problem because of these distances. So now we have to manage our risk much, much differently than we did before. We have to know what that risk is. Of course, we always did. Oh, this is our risk, and this is our contingency plan. But now, we not only have to know the risk, but we have to reduce the risk, minimize it. And then when we're done, we have to minimize it again. So where are we investing? Supplier development. Supplier and commodity management strategies to make sure we're working with the right people, not just the cheapest people. What we want to develop is a total cost perspective, and not a low-cost country sourcing perspective, but a best-cost perspective, a best-cost strategy to resource from suppliers and build our facilities where we can develop the lowest possible cost that is best for the entire supply chain, right? It's not just about our company. It's about our suppliers. It's about our customers. And we want to make sure that those parts that come off that dealer lot are the best possible parts possible at the best possible price. So minimizing that risk. Now, if that fails, we're still going to have emergencies. We're still going to have risk that occurs. We know that. We know that there'll be expedites. One of the things that we can count on is that our team members in supply chain, they really do perform miracles every day, getting material to the line, making sure cars are made. And so those accomplishments in getting things delivered every day gives our management a sense of confidence that they can make good decisions, hard decisions, but they know that they need to look at risk differently. They need to develop best cost scenarios to conduct their business and make sure that we're meeting the needs of our owners, our investors, or the banks that fund us our money. So I ask you to do one thing when you go back to your offices. Walk over to talk to the operations people, the material managers, the dispatchers that perform those miracles every day, and thank them for working so hard for all of us. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mike. Again, really important points there on risk management and managing the total supply chain. Also hitting on, again, the near sourcing and the regionalization trend that we've kind of picked up from other members of the panel as well. So again, thanks again to all of our panelists for their presentations. We'd like to open it up, excuse me, to Q&A now. We have about 20 minutes or so. So if anyone wants to kick us off, You're all still in slight recovery mode. That's okay. Luckily, I've got about 4 pages of questions, so I'm going to keep you all day, I think. So. We started off, Robert talked about localization in Mexico. I think levels right now around 20%, aiming for 50%. Perhaps the other tier suppliers can give us a little bit of sense of their localization rates and what are the challenges for getting up to the targets, Robert, for you and others to where you want to go.
Well, we're working through a lot of different opportunities with suppliers localization, but the obviously having the raw material closer by is a big advantage. And in Mexico, there's a development of some of the industries which are key for us, which are like iron foundries, aluminum foundries. Having the raw material for suppliers available closer in the region is a huge advantage. And I think it's still developing here, but the more that we can help it develop in Mexico, the bigger advantage we're going to have more opportunities for localized sourcing.
Want to comment on that?
Yeah, we're always looking to add more local suppliers, either in Mexico or in the NAFTA region. Being a European company, a lot of our suppliers are based in Europe. We also get some of our key components from Southeast Asia, from China, from Russia. But we are developing some local natural rubber suppliers here in Mexico and in Guatemala. Also carbon black, we're looking at getting it here in Mexico. But being a European company, like I said, a lot of our recipes for tires involve raw materials that are coming from European suppliers.
Mike, do you want to comment on that?
Well, supplier development is an important part for us also, where we're actually working with some of our strategic partners and working with them to open facilities here in Mexico. And, you know, again, there's a lot of advantages, certainly from a freight perspective that I look at. And so we can continue to go down those paths and encourage companies to invest near where we're buying material.
Great. Any questions from the floor? Right in the back. Wait for the mic to come and then say your name and company. And just put your hand up again so he can make sure he sees you. Yeah, there you are.
Good morning. Roberto Michera from Missy Line. Es una pregunta para Volker.
In this room, there are many companies that had invested resources and capital from many decades ago. Some facilities have won awards for the quality of their products and have been in Mexico for several years. Now, I am sure that you will have something positive to tell us about your experience dealing with Mexican workforce in your company. Can you share some positive aspects? Certainly. My experience, or what you mean, that investing in people, managing people, and established here in this country, face the realities is important, so things will work. First, when people come here, you should learn Spanish. It really helps you. Believe me, this is easy. You should go for it. Mexican welcome you with open arms. The other is you must invest training people. It is necessary. I don't know if there are business where there is a possibility to hire qualified labor just by walking on the street. It wasn't that easy for us. And you can say that if you invest in people, if you open up possibilities for them, then people receive this and are loyal to you. Because it is positioned in each person's ranking. If you are receiving training possibilities, because in Mexico, you get education if you can afford it, not if you have the brain for that. So if you help people to develop themselves, to train themselves, there is a huge payback. I don't know if that was your question. We have been able to do many things that are not possible in other countries.
Question right in the front here. Right in the front, we'll start. Unless anyone else, of course, wants to comment on the previous point.
See, this question is for John. John, we saw that you have two big warehouses, one in Georgia, one in California, and your plant is in Silao. Have you considered, or are there any reasons why you are not using short sea shipments from Silao to those places?
We've evaluated short sea shipping to Fontana on the West Coast, and certainly shipping to our Vancouver warehouse, it's an option. Going to our warehouse up in Toronto, it would still involve a significant land dray there in the Northeast United States, which would be costly. Going to Georgia, really the intermodal option is the best option. The sea option, really, there's no cost savings there.
So the short sea is an option, but not being used, you said, for Fontana, for California and?
We are not currently using it for California.
I think we had a question in the middle here. Okay.
Yes, thank you. This is for Mr. Vossler, but it's for everyone. This question is inspired by you and your discussion about training. But I'm from Wayne State University, and universities and business schools and engineering schools, we're suppliers to you all. And so just to talk about, just I want to ask you about how maybe we can work with you all to improve training and education. And I mean, we're a U.S. school, Wayne State is, but we certainly have an automotive focus in our programs. So we just like to talk about how we can work more closely with you all, or for all universities to work more closely with you all.
So maybe more of a comment there than a question, but if anyone wants to respond, of course you're welcome to.
We need to respond something. Yes, of course we work a lot of or close to many universities. The thing, maybe I couldn't make the point so clearly, the thing is not such on an academic level. Yeah? You have quite good universities here, but usually these guys go to the to foreign countries. But the thing is the level, the middle management and the operators. No, there's no technical education here. If you come out from the school, no, from the high school, primaria, or whatever. Then there is no way to learn some technical education as a mechanic or something. As I know this, for example, from Europe and Germany, that is very very implemented for long years. And the workforce has to be trained for the special processes all the time. So would be really great to do something, not just on academic level, to go one level lower and to provide also this education and this training.
I'd like to chime in too.
Yeah,
I think it's important to give students the opportunity to travel abroad. I myself was an international business major, and so for me it was an invaluable experience to be able to go to another country and do internships and co-ops there. So I would encourage students in logistics to go to Mexico, take classes there, and do internships there as well.
Do you have another question? Right here.
Scott Krebs from Orbis Corporation. Specifically to the trend of localization that everybody is working on, do you see any influence, specifically with a lot of the suppliers, European, that are coming into the NAFTA region, do you see any influence or trends happening specifically to over-the-road trucking and any standardization, say, moving away from the North American model?
If you want, I can maybe just make a comment and others as well. But we do see a lot of influence of companies from other countries, from all over the world, Europe, Asia, from everywhere, moving into Mexico to be able to support the automotive industry, but also looking for other customers to diversify their customer base. And I think that it is changing it really improve the opportunities that we have for localization. So we do see that trend increasing. We're encouraging it, and also we're talking with our global suppliers too about, you know, relocating and moving to supply us in Mexico and Central America.
Comment on that?
I think it's important also to do your homework. I mean, not every region is the same. For example, Europe can be very different from North America. Even within North America, United States and Mexico have differences. So I think it's definitely a best practice to go explore the area, learn about it as much as you can before you jump in.
So if we're suddenly having European and North American standards sort of moving on the road, I mean, if you take packaging, I know in China, you know, you've got the German VDA and you've got the French and you've got the American, and I think sometimes that perhaps causes more headaches than it helps. So is that, you know, is there a kind of risk that everyone bringing their own standards, that there's some efficiency that can come out of the system? I guess so, yeah. More of a comment than a question. Any final? Yeah, I think we have a question in the back.
Thank you. Good morning. Alexander from Europe Partners Mexico. Speaking from a freight forwarding perspective and playing off the question of supplier sourcing, what are some of the greater challenges that you've faced so far investing in plants more in Mexico for inbound international shipping as well as outbound or maybe national transportation? What are some of the greater challenges you've seen since coming into the Mexican market? Thank you.
Anyone want to jump in?
I'll respond. I mean, capacity.
We can
always
sit here in silence. It's also
capacity
nice,
is always an issue. Service, especially when we're dealing with original equipment deliveries, on-time delivery. It has to be 100%. You can't be late. You don't want to be responsible for shutting down an automotive factory. So, I mean, it's the same requirements that we have in the U.S. and Canada, on-time delivery, service, capacity.
I think one of the things you always have to take into consideration when you're talking about international shipments, for example, U.S. to Mexico or Mexico to the U.S., is the whole customs piece, customs brokerage, safety, security, all that. So that's always something that's on the forefront with us. The border is definitely an unknown factor. Sorry, I think my mic is. So it takes a lot of planning in order to make sure that the products flow from one country to the other properly. And this is probably a good time for me to plug the think tank that we have this afternoon. We're going to talk about cross-border issues. So I invite anybody in the audience to join that think tank this afternoon.
If I could comment also, you know, one of the challenges, I mean, you know, the no question, getting goods across the border is a challenge. The changing landscape is hard to keep up with. The legal changes, the changes in the requirements in both countries is very hard to keep up with. And the number of audits that occur, in which your paperwork is reviewed, and you're constantly worried about, okay, did we adhere to every rule and ruling that was made in the past 3 months, 6 months, year? It's a constant learning curve, and that's very challenging for our team to keep up with.
Maybe just one last question from my side, and it's particularly to Volker, since he was focusing so much on the labor side and labor management, but any other comments is fine as well. What proportion of your staff in Seglo is temporary workers or agency? I think in Mexico there is, because of some complex labor regulations, tends to be a high use of that. Obviously, you're focusing a lot on retention and stuff. So, I mean, how would you balance that?
Well, the answer is 0%.
0%.
We don't use, I'm a little bit afraid. I guess I didn't make the point at the beginning of this presentation. We have more or less our own personal company. The Seglo staffing section is providing to customers, external customers, and obviously for ourselves also. No? So we don't use external agencies, manpowers to get our people. And that for a reason, because we established all the process because we realized that we have certain requirements to do a right deployment of our activities. And so we established all these training centers and so on. And after a while, our customers came to us and said, oh, maybe for this and this and this guys, you can do the same for us. We said, why not? Of course, we have the installation, we do this. And we do this very focused on processes. No? And we do also the whole selection focused on process to look for people which more or less have a certain tendency to do one or another thing right. No? And we don't use external agencies.
I think it's an interesting point because I think that is perhaps an advantage. I mean, there may be an extra cost to that on one side, but the longevity and the retention benefits seem to pay off. So it's good to hear. I think we're going to end the session there, or at least end the discussion on the stage. We can continue at the coffee break. Thanks again to our panel. Before you leave, let me just make a few comments about a slight scheduling changes. Basically, we've had some more participation from the government coming in now. So we actually have two speakers that we're going to have in the afternoon. We're going to cut lunch a little bit short. We're going to come back into this room at 12:45, just ahead of the round tables, and we'll have about half an hour or so ahead of the think tanks. And there we'll have Dr. David Carrillo Murillo, Director General for Multimodal Corridors and Logistics from the Ministry of Communication and Transportation, so I don't think it's something you want to miss. And we'll also have Federico Gutierrez, who's a Subdirector of Roads and Project Evaluation from the National Infrastructure Fund. So just to plug that and make sure, you know, those of you who are thinking about cutting out early, stick around, it's going to be worthwhile. And as Volker mentioned, you know, a party could break out at any time in Mexico, so who knows, maybe in between we'll also make a party or something like that. So stick around, enjoy your coffee, and I'll see you the rest of the day.